Good afternoon and welcome. I'm Richard Armstrong, director of the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum and Foundation. And on behalf of its trustees and our staff, we're very happy and thank you for joining us today at the summer solstice for the opening of the exhibition, James Turrell. Today's program is part of the Elaine Turner Cooper Education Fund Conversations with Contemporary Artists series. And as you know, it features the artists James Turrell and Michael Govan, Chief Executive Officer, and Wallace Annenberg, Director of the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. Before I turn this over to our exhibition curators, I want to say in particular our thanks to Alan and Stephen Mnuchin for endowing this series in memory of their mother, Elaine Turner Cooper, who was a devoted friend of the Guggenheim and deeply interested in contemporary art. The exhibition, James Turrell, is part of an unprecedented trifecta celebration of the artist's work, exhibitions here at the Guggenheim, the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, and at the Los Angeles County Museum of Art, where Michael also served as co-curator of the show, explore Turrell's groundbreaking career and form an unusual three-part retrospective across the country. I thank my colleagues at both of these museums for their expansive visions, for their marshaling of imaginative resources, and for their great spirit of collaboration. Here, the exhibition was organized by Carmen Jimenez, Stephen and Nan Swid, curator of 20th century art, and Nat Trotman, associate curator. They have done justice again to the work of a great artist. Please join me in welcoming Carmen Jimenez and Nat Trotman, who will further introduce today's speaker.
So, good afternoon. In January 2007, Tom Kranz, the former director of the Guggenheim, asked me to do with him a show of James Turrell. I was extremely happy and thought immediately that Turrell could be the sky space in the Frank Lloyd Wright Rotunda Central Void. In 2009, Richard Armstrong confirmed that he will be very happy to support the Turrell exhibition, which I was already working on with James. Thank you so much, Richard, for your support and great generosity. James Turrell is not only the first artist to make light his raison d'être, he is the first to confront it in itself without mediation. He is the first artist to use light not as a mean, but as an end. Therefore, the Guggenheim exhibition is not restricted to the usual format of an anthology of artworks. It is instead an installation in itself, one that transformed the space into a luminous experience. The Frank Lloyd Wright building has certainly never shone as it does with Turrell. No one who visits it can fail to be struck by the weightless, transfiguring grace of light. I first met James Turrell in 1980 with Count Giuseppe Panza. In 1985, we discussed the possibility of doing a huge sky piece in the courtyard of the new Centro de Arte Reina Sofia in Madrid. Unfortunately, we never able to complete that project, but in 1991, James created a beautiful space division installation called Next Breath for an exhibition I curated in Santander, Spain, Las Últimas Guggenheim, Las Últimas Vanguardias. I have dreamed for years of working with him in the Guggenheim. When James accepted our invitation for this show, I knew that he could make something incredible in the Rotunda. Of course, Michael Govan has been also essential to James Turrell's career. During his early years as deputy director here at the Guggenheim, he helped start the conversation that ultimately led to this exhibition. After a successful career as director of the DR Foundation, where his achievement included opening the DR Beacon Museum, Michael is now the director of the LA County Museum. There, he has recently opened his own major retrospective of Turrell work. I congratulate him on that accomplishment and welcome him back to the Guggenheim for his conversation. Thank you very much.
Before turning the stage over to Michael and James, I just wanted to run through a little housekeeping for this afternoon. Please note that photography is not permitted during the program. And afterwards, during the audience Q&A portion, please be sure to use the standing microphones that are at the front of the two aisles here, rather than calling out your questions, so that we have them all both amplified and recorded. The program today is being live streamed, and we encourage our online audience watching the live broadcast to use the hashtag Turrell to join the conversation and post questions on Twitter. Also, your ticket to this program may be exchanged for access to the museum either later today after the program until 5 p.m. Or tomorrow, June 22nd, or Sunday, June 23rd, from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. Please keep your program ticket and present it at admissions for entry. Do note that due to space limitations within the exhibition, there may be a line to get in. Please also note, pursuant to that line, that museum members do enter on a priority line and that memberships are on sale outside. And finally now, please join us in welcoming Michael Govan and James Turrell.
Thank you. First of all, just thank you, Richard. Thank you, Carmen. And thank you, Nat. It has not only been one of the most fantastic learning experiences and pleasures to work with James Turrell on this huge project, but it is nice to be back in the Guggenheim. In fact, I think this chair was in my office in 1988, so you know they're being frugal. And Carmen, I remember in those days when not only did we acquire the Panza collection, but many discussions with Count Panza and Giovanna about the importance of artists like James Turrell. And I think in those days, there was a little bit of a bias in New York towards New York and New York artists. And interestingly, from Italy, I remember how Panza seemed to make no distinctions. And in fact, he was very proud to give a number of important works that are on view here in the other galleries to the Guggenheims. There's a fantastic history here, and anyway, I'm just very pleased to be here and with you, James, to have a conversation. Maybe we can start, I guess I push this button, is that right?
Yep.
Okay, there, you get James bigger for a second. Somebody asked, James, I think, tried to stall the question about that everyone asks about what his favorite color is. And as he says, he needs every color as musical notes. You need every musical note. You can't have a favorite musical note easily. But I do note that blue is often the color of the day with James Turrell, sort of the corporate logo color. What did you call it?
Branding color.
Branding color. So here you see James in blue in front of his blue, beautiful blue Helio Courier, which he, a type of airplane that he's flown for many years. And I go from that photograph to another fun photograph. I think you may all recognize this as being from The Little Prince. And the Little Prince not only tends his volcano, as James Turrell, I think you do, but one of my favorite parts of the story of The Little Prince is he explains how his planet is so small that when the sun sets, he can then, after it's set, he can pick up his chair and move it a little bit further and see the sun set again. And for me, that's sort of emblematic of your work, James, that it allows us to see the sunset continuously, that sort of radiancy of light. Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, who wrote The Little Prince, was of course was very famous as a pilot. And I wonder, maybe just since it's the two of us here, and I must confess that in I am also a pilot, and I learned to fly encouraged by James Turrell as sort of a research assignment, I think. And I wondered if we could just start there, because in the 60s, You flew with your father once. He was involved in...
Before the 60s.
Before the 60s, right. Yeah. And he was involved in aeronautical engineering, and flight became important to you. And I think once you have said many times that the airplane is your studio. And I wonder if we could just start there with the phenomena of flight and something about aviation and how that did affect your seeing.
I think many people on a long flight to Europe have experienced putting up the shade, perhaps, and seeing sort of amazing events happening as you're flying toward the rising sun. And of course, the pilots up front have the best seat in the house, but it is something that's even good, you know, from the cheap seats in the back. And I have to say that I always used to think about that. The other thing is that when I like to fly, I like to get up early in the morning before sunrise to get in some nighttime flight, but also to be there for the arrival of the sun, because the very sharp side-breaking light really reveals everything in the earth, and there's a beautiful quality that you get just with this kind of elephantine, folded, crusty surface of the earth, especially out in the west. It's very remarkable. At the same time, the thing you find most in the air is just seeing what happens in the atmosphere. And many things like a contrail that then has the sun make this, a line, actually a plane down in the sky that you see in air that has a little moisture in it. Lighting of a fog if you're on top, and there is either a sort of tule fog or convection fog underneath you. The space really takes this color from the sky, from the sun. And so there are some remarkable events that happen. And so that's a great inspiration to me. And I, not so much a studio in the sky as I am an observer and see a lot of the things I would like to think about on smaller scales. One of the best things is the fact that you know, when the sunlight lights the sky, we don't see through it. So here's light that obscures. And this idea that also that can even happen on a stage. If you have enough footlights and these stage lights on you, often you look out and you don't see the audience. The audience sees you. So here on a small scale, it's doing the same thing, where light will obscure and divide space. So the space is made more with where light is and where it isn't than by the physical, solid, concrete architecture of the space. So this is light making an architecture of space that I find quite amazing. And we've seen a lot of that from Hubble photographs and things like that as well.
Right. I mean, you once talked about how you were in art history class and you were seeing the images projected as this image is projected on the screen. And of course, you were looking at the light itself more than the image as one inspiration for thinking about why to focus on light itself. And I mean, I know flying that the light itself, that thick atmosphere can be that also. Are those your origin points for thinking about light?
Well, there are two things about that sort of slide story. One is that we take slides, and that's kind of how we did art history in those days, so that you could have a Barnett Newman, which was a huge painting, and you could have also the Mona Lisa, and they projected the same size. So that scale was oddly disappointing when I often saw works in the actual flesh.
Not here at the Guggenheim, by the way, if you haven't noticed. You're making up for that now.
Okay. Well, that is a part of it, and why we're having it in three museums, because this work sort of luxuriates in space, so to get a retrospective of 23 works representing 48 years, it takes three museums to do so. So that's kind of the reason for that. And I mean, I'm unapologetic in work that requires some space, because to perceive light both as the ephemeral quality that we notably give it, and then also as the sort of physicality that I like to see it with, takes that distance, and then I like to have it be able to be seen as both. One reason for which it photographs so poorly is that the photograph tends to make it one way, sort of more solid than it really is. And also, part of that magic or quality is seeing it both in its ephemeral nature, but also physically residing in the space as well. Mm-hmm. And so those are the two things I like to work with, and that requires some space. So
when you're to go just back to the art history story, the looking at the slides, and again, I can't stop thinking about looking at the sky and looking at smog and fog, and what's interesting about the origins of your seizing on light itself is that you weren't really a painter, you weren't a sculptor previously. So many artists come through these transitions of, you think of Mondrian painting realistically, and then all of a sudden it becomes a tree, and the tree breaks into branches, and then it's fog, and then it's abstraction. But you just sort of go directly to light. And is it as simple as having an epiphany in art history class, or can you pinpoint what that, because it's a big move to just go with light itself. I mean, when you walk into that room with Afram and it's just light.
Well, you know, art history is littered with artists that have used and have depicted light. And Constable and Turner, Caspar David Friedrich and Vermeer, yeah, and all of the Impressionists, and most notably recently, Rothko and Ed Reinhardt, where Ed Reinhardt has this beautiful color coming out of darkness that's so wonderful. So light is, I mean, art has been about light forever. But I mean, maybe I'm just sort of American in that way. I just thought, you know, let's use light.
Simple as that. It's a good idea, right?
Seems rather direct.
So. See how easy it is?
Well, it is.
So Afram is in both museums in different, slightly different forms.
This was the smaller.
Yeah, we actually have a photograph of it. Maybe we can go through these because we have Afram coming up. These are the photographs of the Guggenheim piece, which of course, if you haven't seen it, you wouldn't know what these were photographs of. I think it's kind of stunning. I mean, you look at this photograph and it looks as if there's a hole in the side wall because of the wide angle, but I guess this is illustration of the point about slides in art history. And there is something to that directness of wanting to get around having something that can be photographed, right?
Well, there's a lot of work that looks a lot better than photograph than it does when you actually see it.
Right.
So this helps make up for that.
I never really saw that green exactly, by the way. It's an extraordinary piece, and it is in color, and I think we can, and yet there are these moments, I think of this moment when the color drains out of it from different, once it drains out of yellow, mm-hmm. once it drains out of blue, it's like the Wizard of Oz in reverse somehow, that it goes to black and white. I guess that's, it almost feels like a black and white photograph when you're in there and it does that, and
that's partly because you've been seeing color, and then when it's gone and you just see the grays, that's maybe a part that I like the best. I mean, I like to start with that and then move it into color. But you know, basically, white is all color. So, you know, one of the biggest problems in our culture is that we're a surface culture. So, we think that mixing blue and yellow will get you green, as it does with paint. So it's a surprise when you mix blue and yellow and you get white, because we've been taught the color wheel and we have to learn the spectrum. And so it's very different with light than it is with reflected light off a surface like with paint. So, but you know, you can't get to the moon using Euclidean geometry. It works very nicely on a piece of paper, but even going you know, halfway around the world, you're gonna wanna have some Riemann geometry, and it's going to be, the shortest distance will be a curve line. So we've been learning a lot of that. But, you know, even when we look at our Photoshop and things like that, they're still doing it with reflected colors, mm-hmm. Which is unfortunate. But then, because we're seeing it in light, but then that's how it prints out. So that's a reasonable reason to leave it as that. But now people are printing out less and less.
Right.
Well, this is Afram, and this was one of the early pieces I was working with, because I like this quality. First of all, I've always felt to be a painter in three dimensions, because I'm using light and this quality of dimensionality, almost as a painter would, as opposed to being a sculptor. Yes, this is sort of a solid, but not really.
Yeah, it does. I mean, those of you who've seen this work, and there is a version of this Ephraim one here, and in Los Angeles, we have a larger, even larger projection of this piece, which from 1966, which
yes,
is
that's the first
really
one.
The first piece. And people walk into the room. I mean, I walk into the room, and it's just a stunning thing, because maybe it's a window, maybe it's a cube, but it's definitely not on the wall. I mean, that's the feeling I have, and I think that in part, and I wonder, I guess, I want to ask whether that quality of ambiguity, that is, you leave a lot of space, there is a little question always, even in the Guggenheim piece, in the rotunda, I don't know if you've all felt that it can be a sense that there's a height of 90, 80 feet there, or sometimes it totally flattens, and is that something that ambiguity that you discovered, that you start with, is that a fair thing to say about it being an important part of that visual experience?
Well, that ambiguity is something that's for all of us in life, and I take pleasure in having it, so that sometimes you'll even feel it curving the wrong way. And also, it doesn't look very level. Of course, here you see it standing up in some of those earlier photographs you were showing. It looks like it, whatever side you're on, it looks like it tilts toward that side. So, you know, we have ways of judging things, and I'm interested in, you know, how we ought to really look at how we judge things. I mean, we're quite unaware that we award the sky its color. We think that we receive everything, and we're actively a part of creating the reality in which we live, but very much unaware of our doing so. And I'm interested in kind of giving a little nudge toward having you wonder how we make this, how these things are formed by us.
I mean, that does get to the heart of the issue, I think, for me, of how, when you start your work, that it's a work that relies so much on me being a little bit wrong or prejudiced in how I approach it. Like, you've played with that problem.
Well, we have very prejudiced perception. I mean, we have the perception and the limits of perception that we have being the creatures we are, that is, where we actually see and don't see. And then we have ways that we've learned to perceive. Right. And rather than knowing about that, we tend to make great assumptions. Sort of like the assumptions people make in
real life.
In real life. like marriage. I mean, people often... People have extremely different views of what they're getting into and never happen to express this to each other. And this is also true with how we perceive as well. So I'm interested in the fact that we live in something where we make total assumptions about things, but we're moving into this new landscape, and I'm going to say the landscape of no up, no down, no left, no right. Certainly this landscape without horizon, which is also what got JFK Jr. when he left the coastline, and where you have the lights, it was legal, it was VFR, but right around 3 miles visibility, and you have all the lights of the coastline and, right, and buildings and houses and where people live, and then you turn into the inkwell, the black inkwell that is over the sea, and that's where he lost it. And so we are moving into this realm of and also this landscape without horizon. And so both in also the look up, you walk around New York, and if you just sit in a second floor or second story window and look out at people, nobody looks up. And in fact, walking around looking up a long time, people get a little bit of disequilibrium. So I do like to have people look up. I mean, that's just a nice form. So the fact that we kind of look up to experience is wonderful.
Yeah, I mean, it's just that idea too that, I mean, your work does so often take advantage of the fact that we see what we want to see, at least at first, right? And then you do tend to disrupt that a little bit.
Just a gentle nudge.
Or more. Yes. You heard it here first, that people see what they want to see. This is the Mendota Hotel, which is, I guess, your real first room installation, where you blocked out the windows, and this is in Santa Monica, and you left apertures for light to come in. And I think that, this work actually for me relates straight to Roden Crater, to much of what you do, in the sense of, I think as you've said, you go inside, you need to go inside to really perceive light, to control it. It just seems that so much of your work flows out of these early experiments. Did you sense it then? Could you feel? I mean, you went right from Mendota Hotel Studio to Roden Crater to look for Roden Crater, more or less.
That's true. But the idea, first of all, like in the Sky Spaces, that very early example would be here at PS1. You know, why go inside to look out? I mean, you can be looking at the sky with even a fuller vantage point, but I tend to frame it in such a way that you can, first of all, the sky that looks to be out there all the time, away from us, like the smog in LA is always over there. I like to bring...
And is no longer.
That's right. I like to bring the quality of the sky, or this ocean of air that we're on the bottom of, I like to bring it down so it feels as though it comes right to the top of the space you're in, so it's something you're in direct contact with. And this idea of Plato's cave, or making out this thing that where you let light in, and the cave wall or the walls of the space that you're in become the picture plane, that was very magical to me as well. So that this idea that you go in to gain outlook, on perception, the same way Plato was talking about, this sort of analogy to, you know, everything upside down and backwards when it's on the cave wall, as in the camera obscura, you are in a space that is itself sensing, that is itself like an eye, or is taking the outside, perhaps, and very, very much so, distilling it, but making the inside be an expression of that which is outside. So that was important to me, and I really enjoyed that. And for me to put a shape of light on the wall and realize that it actually couldn't reside on the wall, because if it were a hard form, it would actually seem to be maybe about 2 or 3 inches in front of the wall, or almost hole out or make an opening through it. So it was a very plastic and malleable medium.
Mm-hmm. And when you were doing these, this kind of thinking about, I mean, this is sort of a camera obscura, right?
Oh, yes.
This studio with camera obscura, which is a box with a hole in it with a certain amount of light, which projects. In this case, they were very abstract images, although I never saw this. I was too young to see this. But there were colors from street lights, and I've heard many reports from people who were there.
Yes. More people have actually seen that than came.
The reports proliferate.
Yes, they do. Yes.
So I want to ask this question, though.
The myth of the artist is such that now it's a Starbucks.
Truly, it's a Starbucks. You can go there. but you also have, I sense this idea of the camera obscura, that this container that light enters, and of course the body's one too, right? The pupil serves as an aperture also.
Yes. And well, that was what Plato was talking about. It's how we, this analogy to how we actually perceive, and the imperfections and the discontinuities of perception.
So when you're doing these experiments, this is not just this isn't just a minimalist exercise in reducing art down to a form of light. You have that sense of the body and the being as part of that, which was a little bit of a discussion that was going on in painting, too, about this
yes.
kind of...
Well, of course, I don't feel that these to be... I sort of object to the word experiment, because you wouldn't be looking at the Picasso black and white show and be looking at Picasso's experiments. You're looking at his paintings. And these are statements, so that mm-hmm. in the same way, I like to feel like I'm making a statement. Yes, it's with light and not with... paint, but it takes the same sort of getting to as anybody who paints. So,
but there must also be, because this is the work here at the Guggenheim, this is 67, 68, you were doing these projections. And I can't imagine that a smile didn't come across your face when all the discussion going on is about reduction of form, and you have artists working with very minimal materials, and here you've kind of, it's a bit of a one-upsmanship. Were you thinking, is there a little of that in this work, that's the time, and so you push things to that limit, to nothing?
I don't think I pushed it to nothing. On this piece here, I felt that this light attached more to the floor than it did to the wall,
right,
even though it's on the wall. Supposedly, that's where the image takes place. But what it began to do is it made this very plastic. I mean, the wall is behind it. It's from the floor. These simple things were exciting to me. It's hard to art is not such a big deal. You know, I had a show in Houston, and there were several thousand people who came to the opening, but the same night Stevie Nicks was playing to 60,000. So it's not even rock and roll.
So over time, though.
Yes, but these were some of the things were very small things, and you can see that in a Joseph Cornell, H.C. Westerman, and some of his death ships, and also, you know, they're very small moves and things that are somehow that catch you. But I was very interested in actually having this be a thing. It's not exactly totally disconnected from the projector, but it's something out there, as opposed, and you see that even in the pieces upstairs, as opposed right. to being something that it seems to be projected. Now, there is this art in light in movie, but in the movie, we're not really feeling light because we're feeling the narrative of the story.
Right.
So there's a story that takes place, and that's what we're really witnessing. And the fact that light itself has its own power is best felt if it doesn't carry image. So I have a work that has no image, it has no object, or there's no physical thing as we think of physicality today. And even not much place of focus. Mm-hmm. So you ask yourself, if there's no image, there's no object, there's no focus, what do you have left? Not a whole lot. And so, you know, basically, the thing that was important to me was just the fact that we're looking at light, and that light is accorded this thingness, and that becomes this thing on the wall. And those were the important things to me. Now, in looking at how it is in relationship to, say, at that time, there was a lot of dealing with, especially on the East Coast, with the what was called minimalist art. This is not maximalist. I mean, doesn't have the physicality like large boxes by either Judd or Morris, or so it shared some of that simplicity of how the form was, but in terms of its involvement, was really more to do with perception, or how we perceive, or how we award thingness.
Right.
So it wasn't sort of the deaf and dumb thing that was just there and had its own there-ness. This is something that was accorded thingness by our perception.
Right.
So that was important to me at the time, we made big differences about that with what was going on with what we called the canal aesthetic that was happening here.
Right. Well, and you're playing here with not just painting, but sculpture. We just saw the piece first at the at LACMA, and here's the work at Houston of the same 68 time, where you've sort of flipped the...
And if you go back, you'll see this just turned 90
degrees.
Yes,
just turned 90 degrees.
Yeah.
So it is a play with sculpture also, right? And this geometry.
Well, it's a form with has to do with sort of making form when there isn't any form there, first of all, and then secondly with this, you know, the simple geometry of the rectilinear spaces that we inhabit. I like to use spaces more like this, and at Roden Crater they're all curvilinear, more like the rotunda here, or like the in Maya, in Yucatan, like the curvilinear qualities that I make in the pyramid there.
It's worth also saying, I often get these from people who, especially often New Yorkers, who like the classic white works. But you were invested in color, and I happen to be just so interested in the color work. And I guess you were doing color work from the very beginning. This is from 68.
Yes.
And of course, those early catalogs reproduced these pieces in black and white. And there's this overwhelming sense that all the early work, there is a lot of white work, black and white work, but you were invested and interested in color from the beginning.
Well, white is all color.
Right.
I mean, you only get white by having all color, so I look at white differently. And if you're working with light, you must. I've never made that distinction. It's just like I don't make the distinction between artificial light and natural light. There is no unnatural light. You have to burn something, and the light you get is going to be characteristic of what you're burning, the temperature at which it burns, and perhaps how fast it's moving away from you. So that's where there is a sort of truth in light, which I like to look at. But you know, there are many people that like to make that differentiation. I mean, we do make the light of the sun. That's because we have made thermonuclear explosions. That light is a little bit over the top.
And not that useful in museums.
Right, yes.
But you've explored light in also very traditional media. These, I really love these prints, which you chose to make in intaglio, in etching, in mezzotint. And I can't help, when I look at these prints, of thinking about how Rembrandt loved this medium, because it was out of the blacks of the ink of the intaglio process, the mezzotint, mm-hmm. that one gets light. And I guess you've always just experimented. I won't use the word experiment. You've seized upon materials and opportunities to express light in very
yes.
different forms. Even these, which is yeah. this is not light. This is a piece of paper.
Well, this. I mean, you see the light coming out of the paper when you use a framing projector here, in particular. You can do that with narrow spots as well. I mean, it still will do that, but with the framing projector, you see it quite clearly. So. With such contrast, it really feels like light is coming out of the paper. I've always liked that quality. And you see that in some of the, also the, I'd say more, well, Rembrandt did that very well. Also Dürer did that very well. And I think the one who did it most beautifully with emotion was Goya.
In Los Angeles, I made a decision to, with your approval, to place some of the very newest work, the holograms, next to the earliest work, those projections. And I know you had a show here, and it was not extremely well reviewed of the holograms, and I feel like people don't understand what holograms are or how they function. I've had this experience in Los Angeles that people stay in the hologram room as long as any other room, and they just marvel at the light that they perceive. And you can't photograph it. On the right is one of the works in the LACMA installation, which appears to be a green plane of light cutting through the black picture plane. There's no way to photograph these. And I am curious about how you seized upon the hologram and what you've done with that. And it has become quite important to you, this struggling with the holograms.
It's not the most recent work. I mean, I've worked on holograms since 85, and even with Matt Schreiber from that period, but more early with Robert Gaylor out of Santa Fe. And, you know, everyone just said that you work with light, so you must work with holograms, because it's sort of the original beam me up, Scotty idea. The fact is that it never really worked that way. I always looked at holograms as sort of this strange still life of objects inside an aquarium of pickled light. And so they were quite unattractive to me. And you could have a face, I suppose. It looked quite ghoulish. The strange thing is you can't actually make a hologram of light. So to make holograms that are light and that look like they are light, you have to take a thing and either overexpose it or in some way detail that so that it doesn't have its materiality displayed. Because it is, generally a hologram is just a photograph in light of these objects or things you've photographed. So this took a long time for me to make it look like light, which is kind of the strange oxymoron there. And again, that has happened, and you can see that in these. There's some on the East Coast now down in Easton, Maryland, that look like that. So I always thought, you know, this is secondary art. You have to be a full service artist, so you know you need to make prints, drawings, everything else. So I wanted to make you know, small amounts of light that were ownable, because I seem to make these unownable things. And so I was trying to be an artist to do that, and that was part of the attempt to do the holograms. And I finally got them to work more recently.
Yeah, they do work extremely well in the exhibition in Los Angeles. This is, of course, is not a projection. This is in the high gallery of the Guggenheim, where this is a sort of a shallow space that appears somehow that it is a solid projection. I think if you look at the photographs, no one could tell the difference between this and the projections. And then this is a photograph of a work in Los Angeles that on view in Los Angeles, early work that is not a projection, but a space with a cut in it.
Well, I went from the projections on the wall. So the wall was prepared like a picture plane of a painting, then projection on that. And then I would make shallow spaces or a wall in front of the real wall and have an opening or cut in that. And then finally I began to cut through the wall and the ceiling itself, as I did here at PS1, where Alana Heiss, I think knowingly, but I'm not positive, allowed me to take the roof off. And and here I wasn't able to do that. They weren't for it that much.
That wasn't in the budget
but
this year.
I have to tell you, you know, that if you go to the Pantheon, that's a hole, and it rains right through it. And that structure has been there 2,000 years. You know, what's our problem? I mean,
do we have a vote?
This is an art museum. I don't care who made it. It's made for art. And we're going to put art in it. You know? And maybe the architects, you know, want to have this great love of their cathedrals that they've made that are posing as art museums. But the fact is that this is for art. So, you know, we're going to do what we need to do here. Sorry about the little editorial there, but this has to do with disrespecting Frank.
As certain museums wouldn't let you cut holes in the wall, you did develop ways to cut holes in walls that you built.
Because I just made the building with a hole already in it.
Exactly.
Yes. Yeah. So that did get me toward, as you have always mentioned, toward an architecture, but I've always felt that I'd really make these spaces that contain or perhaps apprehend light for our perception. So that has meant that to make these sort of wonderful light-filled spaces, I get involved in a lot of physicality of building, as we did here too. But, you know, so be it. You know, you look at paintings, there's structure bars behind that and a lot of canvas and preparation.
I've never seen the amount of sheetrock, studs, fabric, and wood ever produced in the service of nothing of the immaterial. That's with a James Turrell show.
Well, that's for the. This is for LACMA,
Los Angeles. When we did the show, of course, it's all light. It's immaterial. Trucks and trucks full of sheetrock would arrive, weighing tons.
Well, in Roden Crater, in the part that we've just finished so far, there's more steel than was in a Liberty ship in World War II.
There you have it.
So yes, there is material involved in experiencing something so light. But you know, I went to school in Claremont where Peter Volkos taught. He wasn't on the faculty because he had too many problems with the pulchritude and getting involved with students. But John Mason was there, Kenny Price
yep.
came and taught, and Paul Soldner was there, and they were all guys that would, you know, they had big pug mills and ground up giant amounts of earth to make their clay and their work, and I remember they were saying, you want to work with light? It was like it was sort of unmanly. And it was only since, and Kenny has a picture in his catalog of the crater. Of course, Ken Price felt that I was a ceramic artist because the volcano is just a rather high fire bowl.
It is. Indeed.
A large high fire bowl, yes.
A container. In the interest of time, I'll move through this is the sky space at Varese. This is a Albers painting, which is just proof again. I always think of your work being engaged with this dialogue of painting, and I, again, imagine a smile on your face when the first sky space, you went through several decades of painting through Albers, through Rothko, and through to Ad Reinhardt in one single sunset, after sunset. But you were thinking of it that way in relation to painting. I mean, the sky spaces really are a picture plane, as are the space division constructions.
Well, part of it is not only just framing sky, but trying to frame an experience. And with, you know, somewhere in the midst of my career, I thought my career was kind of going nowhere. But after now having pieces in now 26 countries and places like Tasmania and top of Norway and Straits of Hormuz, places like that, I do realize that if you do find yourself nowhere, that you're probably somewhat near my work now.
It's true.
But these qualities of framing experience were something very important. I used to have this analogy to taking you, there's a really beautiful plant called the night blooming cirrus that blooms on a moonlit night. There are actually two moonlit nights in the summer that it generally will bloom. Sort of like the cicadas, some are every 17 years, but right now is a very big year, and there's also a big year that was in 85 as well. And so, they're slightly offset in the different varieties, but if you were to be directed to this plant, I could give you a map of a place to go. So you come out to Arizona, you rent a four-wheel drive vehicle, I could get you a map so that if you went into this territory, you were likely to find this plant, this cacti, and you could wait for the sun to go down after you located one, wait for the sun to go down, and then the moon come up over the canyon walls, and this plant actually opens up and literally tracks the moon. It's really quite an amazing thing to see. At the same time, you could have a nice penthouse, greenhouse, here in New York, the same plant, same object of perception. You serve some margaritas with salt and have a nice party, and you can see the same thing happen. So it's the same object of perception, but a very different experience. So if you feel to be framing this experience, then you have to do that as well.
And so Roden Crater has that quality of you would have to go out to the desert. But I've noticed also, and you've cut holes, you've made now 80-something sky spaces in different places and nowhere. And I've noticed your interest recently in coming back inside. And to use the analogy of the plant, where we don't have to go out to the desert if you've structured an experience, I don't know, properly, amazingly. This is a piece, it's the sky space turned on its side, inside, with a source of light within it. The piece upstairs on the fifth ramp, Iltar, from 76, has no color. So
it has color.
It has.
You'll notice it's sort of a gray-green. Because the outside is
the
tungsten light, and so that you'll get the opposite of that, which will be the gray-green, and the tungsten light is this very orange-yellow.
Right, so I should correct myself. It has no light from within, emanating from within, but we do see color. This is the work, St. Elmo's Breath in Los Angeles, and they're both very low-light pieces, and I find that quality of the low-light pieces somehow that your rods and your cones are slightly confused about which is seeing. Are you seeing black and white? Are you seeing in color? And it does have a very emotional quality, and that is like setting up the experience of the night-blooming cirrus in the desert, isn't it?
Well, it is, and this piece here has the pink on top of the blue. it's very much like the twilight arch or the Earth's shadow rising in the sky in the east as the sun goes down in the west. So you'll see that the pink on top and the blue rising, because night doesn't fall. The sun goes down, but night rises, la levée de soir. And that is something that really you feel when you're in a place like the desert or when you're over the ocean. You feel how night rises, and objects that are on the horizon that you see just begin to dissolve in this very sort of a dusky white blue that is night rising.
And so you are able to pull that experience of outside and channel some of
that. I'm a landscape painter.
You're a landscape painter. That's what I wanted to get to. And there you have it. I just wanted to show, this is a work in Los Angeles also, from the Magnetron series, which you originally made for the Mondrian Hotel.
Yes. And in these series, I used to remember walking by apartment, looking into apartments or houses where people were watching TV. And you could often, it's really beautiful because the light would really be suffused into the room that you were seeing, that you were looking into. And in the old days, there used to be only 7 channels. Remember that? And you could actually tell what they were watching. You knew what they were seeing, what channel it was they were watching. And my family was against modern devices, so we didn't have TV, and I had to go down to Peter Arnold's house to see what they were watching on TV. And I remember watching things like Cecil and Beanie, Fran and Kukula, the George Gobel show, things like that. And then coming back, I could just tell what everybody was watching. And so in this gathered light, this is a piece where down at the bottom there's actually a TV that's a magnetron TV because that projects more light out. Many of our TVs today, either plasma or LCD or LED TVs, do not give off much light. They just have light on that surface. So I have to use this old type TV that actually is irradiating people. And
the light change, just for those of you who've never seen one, that surface changes. So unlike the fixed light you get in a space division construction, you're seeing flashing light, slow changes of color.
Yes. I could do 4 different videotapes or programs. I do some that are live over in Japan, like NHK, something like that. And you look at this, and if I were to tell you one is a sports channel, you know, green, red uniform, blue uniform, green, or tennis match, and then another was actually the blue screen of the weather channel, another was cartoon channel, which is brilliant color, change, and another a porn channel, which is skin tone. You could, in just a few minutes, you can, with just seeing the gathered light, the averaged light, you could actually identify what people are watching. So this is just content in the light without any image, which I thought, it's very much like looking at a star. We know a star without touching it by virtue of being able to look at the spectrum that's given. So we know the material that the star is made of, the temperature at which it's burning, and we even know how fast it's receding from us by how that has shifted toward the red in the spectrum. So this idea that there's sort of truth in light and you don't need to actually have, it's like not, like understanding a person that you're with and not needing to hear the words. There's a lot of that, and that's what the Quakers like to think in their silence, that there is this understanding. In fact, the reason the Mennonites and the Quakers split is that the Quakers had silence in English and the Mennonites had silence in German.
Which gets very confusing.
Yes. Absolutely.
I guess those count as your video art too, right?
Well, I had to do video art. I mean, that's something that artists were doing at the time. I wanted to do operas and did operas and did dance performances, lighting and sonography for those. So, wanted to be a full service artist.
So the magnetrons changed because of the television. That one was actually Bullwinkle, so it was it had the colors of Bullwinkle. You've also started to use the new technology of LEDs, which we've talked about this a little bit, but I think when I first met you, you kept saying, well, someday they're going to make, I thought in the 60s they would make a light bulb where the color would just be any color you dialed in.
You can change it remotely. Yeah.
And until this year, that wasn't commercially available. But you've been ahead of that curve, working with these LEDs now for almost 15 years?
Well, since 92, so.
20 years. Well,
yeah.
And
but the LED doesn't have, I mean, the light is quite going to be very harsh or flat. It's only recently that it's become more suffuse. I recently made up for that by using 7 colors of LEDs, but actually it was easiest to use neon, because neon had a really beautiful, rich color. I worked with Eric Elaine, who was in Paris, who really was able to control neon, so you could bring it down below the 8% where it normally flashes off. If you have things like neon or cold cathode or fluorescent right. tubes, you can dim them, but that doesn't mean, what happens is that you always have to have them on a little bit, so it whites everything out. So if you're mixing red, green, and blue, you actually can't turn off. If you want to get blue, you're going to have a little bit of red, you're going to have to have a little bit of green there, because you can't turn them off all the way. But he made ways that we could get them very low in their emission and still be able to reignite or come back on without a pop or a flash. So I worked for a long time and still do with neon, because it has a more beautiful color. The LEDs will have a spike on the spectrum that looks like this. So this would be red. Well, for you, I'll make it, this would be red over here. This would be green over here. Then the high end of the spectrum is blue here. And they were spikes. So when you mix them, it was oddly flat. If you're doing it with neon, you'd have a red here that was representing a nice curve like this. So you were actually getting more light than just the red. So it would mix more richly. It's sort of like Windsor and Newton compared to cheaper colors, that sort of thing.
I know we want to go to some questions in a bit, but I just maybe to this is another work that's in Los Angeles, which is a wedge work, quite extraordinary and impossible to photograph, because you actually feel like you could enter that fog. This is the piece in Houston that is between the two buildings.
We go back to the one before. Yep. These are ones that I used to let you enter. In fact, Richard Armstrong, who used to be a curator at the Whitney when I had the show at the Whitney in 1980, had to walk through a similar piece that was blue to get to his office. So he would take off his shoes each day and walk into his office and not have so many visitors, because in order to come, they would have to take off their shoes, not something that's done in the West as much as it is in Asia. But that's also a work that did result in a lawsuit, because someone, I stopped letting people in America walk through them, because there was a woman who, her testimony is, there was a receding wall, I leaned against it, and it wasn't there.
Well, at least we know the art works. Proof, well, legal proof that you've made light physical.
And that was a blue piece, and her hair matched it. But, you know, now I need to use a blue rinse myself. There you are.
So I wanted to end on this note of looking towards architecture, and I want to say something about, this is the piece in Houston where it's the passage between, underground passage between the two museums, where you do feel there's a physical space on each side of you of light. This you've allowed people to walk through by having a path.
Yes.
And you've been really interested, again, in coming back inside.
Well, there also at the Whitney, there was a piece that, like this, an aperture work in the wall, like Iltar upstairs, and a woman dove into it, thinking it would be soft.
The light is soft.
So basically here I've just put stairs up to it to assist you in.
Well, Which I was what I was going to say. You've wanted to indulge people to walk into the light. So you started, these look like these space division constructions. You put the stairs up so people could dive in. This is its changing color. So it's employing these LED lights so that light changes. This is also at LACMA, a work that you call a Gansfeld. And then this is inside.
This is the new landscape of No Horizon. But it only happens occasionally, because if it were all the time, it is harder to stand up. I do admit that. So, but you should always stand up to contemporary art.
And I want to say that for a artist with white hair and a beard and now 70, you seem to be involved in very advanced ideas still, even though your airplane...
But I don't do email.
You don't do email. Your airplanes still have tail wheels on them. They still don't even have a nose wheel on them, so they're all from
they
the 30s.
They have GPS. So.
And yet you're using the highest technology, computers, changes in light, and talking to me about these new landscapes, which you do liken to not only space travel, but the internet. And I mean, you're serious. It is a new landscape we're entering, right?
We have entered it. I mean, that's how Sonny Bono hit a skylift stanchion, how JFK lost it over Nantucket or toward that area of Martha's Vineyard. Also, you have this with diving, where you get rapture of the deep, and often people don't know which way is up. You have to look at your bubbles to find out, you know, where it is, because you have neutral density and you've taken away the sensation of gravity, which also happens in flight. So that we are moving into this territory physically, definitely, and we're moving to it in thought, in the Boolean topology of our computer spaces that we are creating. And this is something where thought is really involved in that. And I think that it's good that we get used to it, the physicality. There are even sensations that are pleasant. I mean, people can go up and do some aerobatics in the air and you can lose your lunch. But at the same time, as a pilot, and you begin to do that after a while, you actually get to like those sensations of less than full gravity or more than 2 Gs, 3 Gs. Those are things that actually are exhilarating. Right. And so, and that happens with art too, as you get more into it. And one of the problems that I've always felt with contemporary art is that people don't enter it with the same kind of discipline that we have in how we enter the literary world of a book. There are times when you're reading a book and you are so into the world generated by the author that people pass through where you physically sit and you don't notice them, because you are more in the space of the book than you are in the place where you physically are located and sitting. So that entry, we have this discipline of entering that. We used to enter the painting. We used to have a discipline of going into it because of how we looked at painting. Today, it's gone very fast through that, but I think that people aren't entering the world of the artist in what they've made. And if you actually get into what is in front of you, I think that that's really immensely rewarding, and that's what artists have always wanted to put in front of you. And I think that, first of all art is contemporary art because it had to be made when it was now. There's nothing but contemporary art that you're looking at. And if you're having a hard time living in this world today, of course you'll have a hard time looking at today's art.
A little lesson in art history and perspective. I want to leave maybe a last question. This piece, by the way, is also worth the trip to Los Angeles, as is the whole show. So I will make a pitch to see the totality of the work. I mean, we did conceive this exhibition that no single museum could luxuriate in the space required to sense the range of emotions and expression in your work, James. And so that was why we conceived of this multi-site retrospective. And so I would encourage you all to travel to LA also. This piece, the Gansfeld alone, is such an immersive experience where color continues to change, but you're literally within it. And the one thing that I noticed, this quality that because I always have after images when you've given me a strong color, and then you present another color, and I am sure that the color that then I'm experiencing is neither the color you've presented nor the color that I've projected, but something absolutely in between, that it's neither the work nor me, and you've created an art that is literally a complete collaboration between the phenomena and the viewer.
Well, also one to see is this piece called Bin du Shards, which actually I think you have as Light Rainfall, and that is a piece that comes out of this work. Here it is, right here.
Yeah.
And
this one.
I remember having an MRI at one time and thinking, you know, I'm in there for 1 hour and boy, I'm strapped into the thing, I'm not moving, and there's no there. There's nothing that I got out of it. So I thought, well, you know, this idea of submission to art, just to be able to do that, I could really involve you in this behind the eyes seeing. This is this other seeing that has, it hardly even matters whether you can close your eyes, it still works. And this has to do with this seeing that is how we generate sight. And this idea that's very, very much involved with the seeing that happens, you know, with your eyes closed. I mean, we have a full vision at night in the dream. Fantastic lucidity of color and resolution, and that's with the eyes closed. And some of the qualities of light that I like are like how you see light in the dream. It's just that you don't normally see it like that with your eyes open. So I wanted, first of all, an art that reminded you of that world that we also have, you know, 7 to 8 hours a day, as well as then this piece begins to then enter that territory, to work in that territory of behind the eyes seeing. So I think this is what is really worth the trip here, and it's a bit invasive in that the only way you can really stop it is to put the full meat of your hand over your eyes. The fingers won't stop it, and closing your eyes won't stop it.
So this is true. So if you don't understand exactly what this is a piece that's in Los Angeles. You can sign up online. In fact, I think we're sold out nearly to October, but there are still slots beyond that for your travel planning. You will be greeted by LACMA employees in lab coats, and you will sign a small release form, and you will enter this chamber, and it is invasive. It is not a seeing that is outside the body. It is a seeing entirely internal. I've never experienced myself anything like this, and I part of the reason we were so interested.
If you go back to these, this is with Robert Irwin and Ed Wertz.
Yeah, this one.
Ed Wertz was a physiological psychologist, and he was training the astronauts to walk on the moon. Also to be able to function with very high G takeoffs, because the early rockets were, you probably know, remember, it's like the V2, it really shot off, and so the Redstone rockets that were Mercury and the, you know, the later, even the Atlas, had rather high acceleration. And so this caused the hearts of the astronauts to fibrillate, and they needed to, first of all, calm them down before the experience, because you have expectation. And so they were teaching alpha conditioning, or essentially meditation, first of all, so that they would not generate adrenaline before they went on this. So they had to have this way of calming down. Then they actually taught them to slow down their heart rate. So I was involved coming out of psychology, and so I worked with Ed Wertz and Bob Irwin, and also David Nolas and Garst Rees to do this. And we did quite a few of these works. And I had been working that way at Pomona College in the psychology of perception, and then continued these pieces. So the pieces that you see later, do we have any of the ones of the small spheres? We're dealing with small spheres.
No, yeah. I don't.
They used to start out in psychology classes with ping pong balls over the eyes, so that you could then project light onto these ping pong balls, and there would be a amorphous or GANS or overall homogeneous field of light. And with that, then you could deal with this perception. And I think that that was, so we started with that and then made larger and larger, and finally I made these 4-meter spheres.
So those photographs are from 1969 Art and Technology yes. Project at LACMA in Los Angeles, and of course this is LA today, and it is just a mark of this ongoing thinking and research, I think, and I know you don't use the word experimentation or you don't want to, but I do sense that because...
Well, it requires that. It's just like you make drawings before you make a painting, and you, so you do this sort of research, if you want to call it that. It makes it feel sort of oddly scientific, which it's not. I mean, because I'm not really doing... my work does not illuminate science. It can illuminate or inform a scientist, but it is not right. pushing science forward.
But it does require a certain amount of science research and thinking to create these situations.
It takes some work and actually going in, looking at it yourself hour after hour. And
doing.
So everything that you've said that have experienced in this, I have experienced more so, I mean, over since the 60s, yes.
But are there, why don't we... See if there aren't questions to line up at the mics while you're, yes, go ahead. Is that Phyllis?
Yes, yes. I wrote it out. I was wondering if you would talk about how you sequence the colors and program the time, particularly in places as varied as, say, Claremont College or the University of Illinois at Chicago, or the swimming pools in Greenwich, Connecticut, the swimming pool in Napa Valley, or Tasmania and Cadiz?
We're talking about the programming and
the
involvement
of
the time.
Sequence, yeah.
Yes. I was very taken by different artists that were always would talk about, and also composers talking about the music of the spheres. And so I was very interested in how these things progressed. And the timing that was very interesting for me was the timing of twilight and how it takes about 45 minutes to an hour and 20 minutes to go through the twilight of sunset. And so I began first working with that because that's something that is happening to us, quote, naturally, something that we do. So I get involved in that kind of timing and have worked even with Philip Glass. He's going to come and do a concert here in relationship to this piece, and then I'm going to be working with him and with Lucinda Childs to make a work as well. But it's not 5 hours like Einstein on the Beach, and I haven't been programming like that. But so this is something that does take place over time and is slow, partly because I think maybe I'm a little slow, and that way I can sort of understand what's going on. So if you look at the pieces as in the sphere, that's extremely fast. That's actually starting a signal across the synapse, and before it gets across, interrupting it with another. So those are very, very fast. So it's not that all the work I do is very slow. But I've tried to give it something so it exists in time, but a little bit outside the time that we enforce by these devices that we have on our wrist and by our cell phones, which enforces a time that's, I think all of us have trouble really living in. So I'm trying to find this time that I like and I'm comfortable with, and that's pretty much the time that I've used in doing this.
In your installations that are open to the sky, for example, the Ringling Museum in Sarasota, where the colors change around the perimeter as one looks at the sky, could you explain what is actually happening in the eye or the brain that causes one's perception of the color of the sky to change simply because the perimeter is changing?
When you were in the piece here, in the rotunda, particularly when it's in the orange or red stages, you can look out into the anterooms outside and you'll notice that they are a very beautiful green. So this has to do with the after image that's produced by looking at a color. And in fact, even when you look at a color and it stays, it's not changing, that color is leaving and you can't hold it more than about 8 seconds. So in the piece in Los Angeles, the pink piece that your daughter likes, that's one where you go in and you feel this richness of color when you enter, and then it just begins to fade. So we, by virtue of how our eyes are formed, and by virtue of the context of vision, which is what Albers would often work with, he could take one color, if it were, say, backed by a blue, and in the same color, backed by a maroon, you would perceive these two colors as being absolutely different, even though they were the same, because the context of vision has changed. So we have, strangely with the sky, we award it its color. It's not something that it has. We like to think that the sky is blue because of nitrogen scatter. And yes, that's somewhat true. But the fact is our vision is formed from the context of vision more than it's formed with what's out there, so that we award the sky its color. And by virtue of that, I don't change the color of the sky, but I change your context of vision and therefore change the perception of what you see in that opening. So I'm using light, and I'm using light this way, not so much for you to see that light, but for you to see the resultant change in the context of vision of the sky. Is that a reasonable explanation? Or, I don't know if that.
What's happening in the eye or the brain?
Oh, what's happening is that when you are seeing red, it is producing a pale green. So if you have a blue that is actually, let's call it there, this mixes with this pale green and makes a resultant color that's quite different than what you would see if you stepped outside this space to look at that sky. So that I'm using the color, the light is not something you're even going to see or look at. You're seeing it, what you're seeing is what then happens to the eye in the brain, as it is, in that opening. So this mixing of the color that may be there and the after image of the color that I presented is what you end up seeing. That's a, you know, basically that's sort of a, as much of a, an explanation I can give, but I want to say that basic, what I really try to do is I make this kind of series of almost emotions. I mean, this is a very emotional art. People always talk about how it was done or how it was accomplished rather than what it is, what's going on, because I feel that actually this idea of something that is resplendent or whatever you want to say, that it actually has this effect on us, not just in what we see, but in what we're feeling. And I think that the eyes are probably the most feeling part of the brain. They're the most exposed part of the brain, because this is a preprocessor, this eye that we have. And I feel that we can, especially when we lower light to a place where the pupil opens, when the pupil opens, then feeling comes out of the eye like as touch, comes out as touch, and we really sense it then. So that's why I like to reduce the light level, so we're really then feeling light. And for me, that's what's happening.
Do we have time for a couple more questions? Yes, we do, right? Two more? Okay.
Yes, if I understand very well, you worked more than 45 years. I wanted to know if your perception, your own perception has changed, if you remember how you perceive 40 years ago and if you perceive differently now, the same art pieces, for example. And my second question would be about the new generation of artists. Many young artists are using light. What do you think about them? I don't know, Anne-Veronica Jensen or Olafur Eliasson. So how do you look at them? Because in fact, they are a kind of sons of you. Thank you.
Well, I first of all thought that this would be more exciting to more artists than it turned out to have been. But I'm really pleased to see that there are people that are taking this into the future. So that's certainly gratifying. I won't take any claim for that, but I will say that my perceptions have changed over the years, and things that would excite me before are more commonplace today. But I still love the things I remember seeing very early on. As I was describing to you about the light on the wall and just how magical that was, that I couldn't get light to lie on the same plane as the wall, so that I really felt it was very plastic and malleable medium, and that was exciting. So that's a very small thing. The other thing was when I first got the light to reside in the space, as in the piece up here called Iltar, where you could see the walls that were in the space, but to see those walls, it felt as though you were looking through something, or the sort of fog of light inhabiting space. And the poetry of the sort of the penetration of vision, how you could, sometimes it would look as though it was screened across the front, almost opaque. Sometimes it would yield the vision as you looked into it, you could see further into it. Those were, you know, the plumbing of the space with vision was something very exciting to me. So that's how I started out. I still do feel that, and sometimes I'll be reminded that I'm often working in a way that I know very well because I did that before. At other times, I'm advancing things and seeing things I hadn't seen before. Sometimes things I never noticed before. So that happens with all of us. It certainly happens with us in all parts of our life, that we begin to see more deeply, perhaps have a little more wisdom, and sometimes we do wonder, what was I thinking then? I felt that often.
Yes, do we have a last question here?
I'm wondering, with your many interventions here at the Guggenheim, if you feel a kinship towards Frank Lloyd Wright and his interest in the geometry of space, bringing the outside in, and ancient temples, if you have anything to say about that.
Very much so. Yes, I guess I would be interested in modern temples. This is certainly one of them. And here, the number of levels are absolutely reflected in the differentiation of the height. This is sort of, each of those levels is at the height of the entry from the elevator area, so the semicircular cut into his circle. So in that way, I've honored those numbers of tiers that he had. And it's interesting. I do have objection to how architects have made modern museums. They've made it often very difficult for artists of today to do their work in them. I mean, not just the fact that you can't hang a painting level in this museum. So if you have anything bigger than a vertical, Juan Gris or something like that, if you have larger paintings, it becomes very difficult. Somehow we've awarded this to the architect because we're not doing that with our cathedrals. So the modern cathedral has become the art gallery. So I object to architects doing this to us. If you were to do that to a manufacturer where you built for them a factory that couldn't bring out next year's models, you'd fire the guys. You know, and we're unable to do that because of the relationship, which ought to be investigated by the SEC, of trustees that own work and their involvement with the museum, their involvement also with these architects. So, but that's my own personal opinion, and you'll have to let that go.
I would say as a note on that, James, that Frank Lloyd Wright designed this building before some of those big paintings. They were smaller in those days, and that one of the things that resonates very...
Guernica.
Very...
Guernica is before.
Yeah. It was still in Spain at that time. I guess it had come over.
Night Watch.
Night Watch.
But one of Hila Ribe, the founder's mission in this building, was to express a volume and to have a sense of being a modern temple. And she did envision from the beginning that artists would create work inside that rotunda using the architecture. In fact, Moholy Nagy was supposed to create light projections of geometry. So in some strange way, I think you have also completed the imagination and the vision of the founders of this museum for a non-objective art that would take advantage of the height, the light, and the space. It was actually envisioned in those days, and it wasn't done in those days, but you've done it now.
Well, you know, that took everyone here and considerable risk from the director and the people who sponsored the art, because if this didn't work, we would have had a firing of the director here. So, I mean, I just want to say that they went out on a limb to do this, and that was terrific. It worked, and I'm very pleased, and I'm relieved. My biggest emotion is relief.
So I think we all owe a great debt of gratitude to
Richard.
to Carmen and Nat, and to the extraordinary team here at the Guggenheim who put this, I think, historic work together. The Guggenheim did an incredible thing here, and especially to you, James, for being here and for giving this to us. Thank you.
Thank you.